Hey guys, welcome to the fourth episode of Suits and Sports. And joining us today, we have a prominent sports lawyer from India. Her name is Ms. Rashi Tata. Hi, ma'am. Thank you for coming. Thank you for accepting our invitation.
Hi, Ryan. Hi, Shubhjit. Well, prominent. Let's take a while for that. It's going to take a while for that. I'm just new in the industry. It's been a year, two years now. Like second year is running in the sports industry. Otherwise, yeah. So prominent is yet to come. But yeah, thank you for that introduction.
Nobody. So
I think, ma'am, it's already a prominent because we have seen you in many fields. We have seen you in like your activeness through LinkedIn. Also, we know you from Kira Legal. So now you're at TFT and AIM. So it means like when people are following you, it means like you are the prominent.
Well, I'll take that as a compliment then. Thank you so much.
Yeah, so today we are also joined by our founder, Mr. Subrajit. And so, yes, welcome to this episode. So our guest, first question to you, ma'am. By the way, guys, ma'am is an avid sports lawyer, sports lover, by the way. She loves cricket especially. So, ma'am, could you please tell us as to who particularly, which player in particular got you to love the game of cricket?
The player who got me to love the game of cricket is definitely going to be Zahir Khan. But then the moment I started following cricket hard in a hardcore manner, there's a really very long list and it just doesn't end. It keeps on, you know, the players keeps on adding and adding in. But to name a few, I won't, let's just not keep the Indians, keep the list restricted to Indians. So I'm going to start with Kumar Sangakkara is one of my favorites. James Anderson. I'm more of a bowler fan. So I'm a bowler myself. So James Anderson is one of the players. And as I said, Zahid Khan. Currently, from the current picks, it's going to be Jadeja and Virat Kohli. First, for those who know me, they know I'm a Virat Kohli fan, just to put it out there like that.
So in this case, if we are to choose anyone, who will be you?
One? No, I'm not going to choose. See, I mean, they come from, you know, the list is very, very spread in a very long, large span of years. So no, there's no, I cannot choose one. There's never going to be one cricketer, so to speak. I can choose a football player for that matter or a tennis player, but I can never choose cricket. Cricket is like I've been playing cricket since I was, 3 years old? You know, literally, like I have an elder brother, so he used to play cricket. And he was 9 years when I was 3. So he had all the equipments, all the, you know, the bat, the ball and everything, the plastic ones. So I used to play since I was 3. Cricket is, I've grown playing cricket only. Like, and then in the later years in the school and everything, I started playing other sports. But cricket is like, I mean, I don't even have one single term for that. Like my entire family, all 5 of us. My parents, my brother and my sister-in-law, all 5 of us are like massive cricket fans. Like me and my brother have woken up at around 3 a.m. to watch test match. And I can also watch test match between Kenya and Zimbabwe. That's how, you know, massive a cricket fan. It's the game that I love. So anybody who plays well is a favorite. So no, I cannot choose one. I can choose a team though. If you want to know, I can choose a team, but I cannot choose a player.
Okay, ma'am, since you said that, which team do you support?
Of course, I mean, it's going to be India, but other than in the IPL, it's definitely going to be RCB because Zahir Khan Zahir Khan has switched teams, but yeah, he was at one time in RCB. So, and then Virat Kohli, of course. So yeah, it's going to be RCB and I hope that they win someday.
Ma'am, if you have to like select one team or not the Indian team, which other team would you support? Like more or less a team whom you've always supported, but not the Indian team. Which country is that?
There's always been a tie sort of thing between England and Australia. The game was introduced to us by them, right? So it's like, you know, when you see, I mean, Ashes is a tournament is a series that, you know, it's fun to watch. So I always watch that. But then, yeah, other than India, it's going to be England and Australia.
Who do you support?
Don't ask me Ashes. Who I choose. Yeah, just say that. No, no. Whoever, it's always the bowlers who I support in Ashes. or anywhere other than India, it's always the bowler. So whoever bowls well, and I hope that every bowler, especially pacers, I'm a medium pacer, so to speak, myself. But yeah, I'm not a big fan of batsmen, to be honest. I mean, and especially with the T20 format, it's like batsmen are just hitting everything out of the park, abusing the bowlers as much as they can. However, I do like the batting style in test match, but no, I'm not a batsman myself, to be honest. I'm the last one. I'm the 10 now. Last 11th player.
So you're more like UG.
No, even worse than him. He can at least pad up and go and bat. I'm worse than him. I cannot wear those pads and, you know, all the gear. I just give me gloves, give me bat, and I'll be fine. But I can wave up my bat, my batting number and give it to somebody else. When I was young, you know, you used to do that majority wins or that numbering on the back in the gully cricket thing. So if there were five players, the numbering would happen only for between the four, because I would choose the fifth one and bowl first. So that's how crazy a bowler I was. Yeah.
So I have another question for you, which is like there is two eras, right? Which is the one, this is modern era of cricket, and one, our childhood era, which was the 90s era, right? When the team was like, even this, like we have seen Zimbabwe, then Kenya have played for World Cup, even for semi-final. Even, we will not forget that thing, we used to say that Ricky Ponting has a spring in his bat. That era which I'm talking about. So which era you will prefer?
Well, to be honest, I was born in 94 and I started watching cricket I used to play when I was in 97, 98, but I started watching cricket a bit late. Like, you know, following cricket, watching, I mean, of course, if it's there on the TV, I would just sit and watch. But, you know, when you follow cricket, like the favorites come up when you follow cricket. So, I mean, of course, it was a great era with the likes of Ponting and Michael Clarke and Haydens and the way, in fact, the way even our team was. But I would say I'm more of a 2011 World Cup child rather than the 90s kid in terms of cricket. I mean, of course, I'm a 90s kid. But then when it comes to cricket, I'd rather keep myself restricted to, the time span from 2005, 6 or 4 for that matter. 3, in fact, 2003 World Cup also. But then till and so on. And 2011 is, of course, by far the best memory I have in terms of cricket. But I've heard a lot from my father and my mother for that matter. And they both are massive cricket fans. Like I think I've gotten from them only. They follow like mad. I mean, all of us, you know, my mother wakes up earlier in the morning and all of us are sleeping. And we wake up to the cricket commentary. If there are test match in the morning, we wake up to that. So it's like I was, you know, that's why I say that when I say I grew up watching cricket, that's how massive cricket is followed in my house. But I would say that I like the way we used to play cricket back then in gullies. You know, the way we, it was more out there in the physical premises than on the phones. So now people play cricket as a game on their mobile application. Although I do like that the video game that we used to have, EA Sports, I think EA Cricket, that was great. But I don't like the mobile application bit. I mean, as a lawyer, I love gaming, but not when it comes to a comparison between physical premises cricket and mobile application. But I'm more of a gully cricket person. Like I used to love that. So that happened when we were kids. So yeah, I would say that. Yep. I would rather choose that part than the modern era.
This our pupil like Ryan has only seen that type of thing in Dream 11 ad, but we have experienced that in the practical.
Sir, I'm not
sure
that generation.
Ryan and I are not. Yeah, I mean, Ryan and I had kind of had a bit of both of the best worlds, I guess.
So I still remember my summer used to be going to cricket camps. I don't think kids even know what a summer camp is nowadays. That time we had summer
camps.
No, they
do. All those. They do, but their focus is more on the tablets. No, they do. They do. It's not that. I mean, see, to be honest, nowadays the competition is even cutthroat when it comes to, you know, these camps. And there are not, come on, what are you saying? There are non-stop classes, there are camps, there are different classes, all kinds of classes. For us, it was just get the homework done and go out and play. That's it. That's how it was. So yeah. I'm sure Shubhrajit has just, immensely been in love with that part. So that's why I think he's advocating for that much. But I agree, Shubhrajit. When it comes to playing, I loved that era. And since I couldn't watch that era as much as I did the modern one, but of course, I mean, these are legends. You know, you are speaking of legends. So yeah, I mean, both. Cricket is a game I love, so I love every era, to be honest. There's no comparison. It has evolved every single day. So
to those watching, one thing I'll tell you, never get into an argument with ma'am regarding cricket. Don't ever say that, you know, cricket is a slow sport or anything, because she will kill you right there. So just
cricket is in fact a longer sport, you know, like earlier we were talking about it. Cricket, yeah, I mean, test cricket is slow, but it's beautiful, you know, it's longer, it's beautiful, but definitely not boring.
What's your view on the T10, the new format, maybe the new format, T10 I'm talking about, not T20 I'm talking about. Do you think it's like a... killing the face of the cricket, the main face of the cricket, ODI, because we feel like, see, don't take me as offense, like the Gunda of Indira Nagar is known for a batsman, and he is one of the best batsmen because he used to stand in the crease for a long time. And that's the reason he got world. But if we put him for T10, I think he's not, then we will consider him not a good batsman. But he is genuinely a very good cricketer. Do you think like the T10 format is killing the face of the cricket?
I wouldn't term it that way. It's not killing, it's evolving. Of course, I mean, see, one who is a true cricket fan, you know, somebody who loves cricket from the heart and, you know, loves the game, will definitely love a test match any day, you know, a five-day test match, and would follow the 3-day also. But 3-4, I mean, whichever. Jo bhi jitte bhi din, however long it goes on. But when it comes to T10, it's rather than the players, I think it's because of the viewers, you know. So if you keep somebody who can play for a longer time on field in a T10 match, I'm sure he'd play for the entire match. You know, he has the capability to stay there for as long as possible. Of course, he will have to score those runs, you know, he'll have to hit hard and, you know, hit the ball for every delivery out of the park. But then, I don't personally think that it's killing the face of cricket. It's evolving with the time, with the generation that we are in. And of course, I mean, the kids, they like these formats. So I wouldn't say that it's killing the face of it. Of course, somebody who's conventional would, I mean, there are probability, there's that possibility that somebody who is conventional would not probably, you know, follow or like that sort of a tournament, but it's evolving. It's nice. I mean, to have something new is, as you said before, you know, you felt that cricket was boring. So it's just a way to keep people entertained is what I think.
Fair answer, ma'am. Thank you. Ma'am, so I think now I'm going to move into a little different aspect. So, ma'am, if you know, recently the IPL stopped in between. And for sure, like when there's a halt for a tournament just like this, I want to ask you, how important are lawyers? Like how important is their role? Because obviously they would have played a big role in ensuring that the contracts stay intact and stuff, keeping in mind that there is a possibility that it can continue while there is a possibility that it cannot continue. So how do you think a lawyer comes into place in this regard?
It starts, of course, while initiating the tournament, while the draft for the contract are in place. You have to be a little foresighted, and especially considering the pandemic. This is the second year that we're in. So I'm sure I don't personally have a hand on those contracts, but as a lawyer, if it was me, I would have definitely captured that situation, that in the event, like earlier, force majeure clause, for example, was not highlighted upon so much, but now it is. So now if I'm drafting a contract, I'll keep that in mind. It won't be just, see, IPL is postponed, you know, it's suspended. It's not, the event is not how do I say, cancelled. I mean, they are still planning to do it, you know, to complete it. But so you draft a force majeure clause in that manner, that what happens if it's cancelled, what happens if it's postponed, you know. That is one. The payment terms, of course, are to be kept in mind according to these sub-clauses, as in what happens if the event is cancelled. You also have to keep in mind that the players are not just playing IPL, you know, they are playing other leagues as well. So you have to keep that in mind also, that there, you can't vaguely put an unreasonable obligation on the player that no matter what, if the event is happening, you have to come back. You know, you can't do that. So it's of course based on what the player's obligations are, what other contracts are. So you have to sort of think like that, in that manner, be a little foresighted and capture every possible scenario that you think would happen. So, and that comes with experience also, that comes with situations, that comes with learning, reading, guidance from seniors. I'll be very honest, like, because I'm new in the field, a lot of my drafts are based on the guidance of what my seniors tell me, because they have been in an industry for over a decade now. So yeah, I mean, it happens that way. So force majeure is definitely one of those clauses. Payment terms, yes, and obligations on the players. And it's not just with the players, it's also with the other stakeholders, like the sponsors. Like, what happens if, how about a sponsorship deal? Like, what happens if a sponsorship deal is, in deep waters because of the cancellation or because of the suspension of the event? So you have to take care from each and every angle. And of course, it depends on as a lawyer, it depends on who you are representing. So if I'm a sponsor, I will, you know, divide my payment terms accordingly, like what I'm doing while the event. And it's not just while the event, right? A sponsor's duties come before event also, in promoting the game. So it depends. Like, just because the cancellation happened, it should not be the point that I will not be paid for that part which I've done in before the event is launched. So you have to take all of that into consideration and you draft the clauses accordingly. So impact is there, yes, and it's huge. But see, I mean, BCCI is definitely planning to, that's what the news says, that BCCI is definitely planning to reschedule it somewhere in September, I guess. Let's see how it goes.
So taking it as the context of BCCI, I want to ask one question. Just today, I think, tomorrow, it was even in the Pakistan Cricket Board has came out a new rule for the women's team, right? Like the parental
rule.
Rule
for the
women's cricket, right?
Women's cricket, yeah.
Recently, there came out some rules, like if someone is maternal, they can take a maternal leave, then they can come back to team. In the maternal leave, they can be like, go for some different jobs and all. They have given some certain clauses and there. So, see, we say Pakistan is a male-dominating nation. Or very few people say it's like that. And so, taking India as a tangent, also BCCI. Still now in BCCI, I think, still now we don't have that type of clauses which Pakistan has developed. And I think Pakistan first time came up with this type of very friendly clause for the women's cricket team. So what's your view on that? Do we also need to come out with this type of clause, as BCCI is one of the dominating body in cricket? And secondly, I want to ask another question, which was like, we have also a women T20 league, which is more like an IPL visa. But I personally feel that there is something lacking behind in that tournament. We have very reputed players with us, well-known players with us. But though having a well-known player with us, we're still not lacking behind a certain part. So, what's your view on that, man?
Okay. Well, to answer your first question in terms of leaves, like maternity leave and stuff, to be honest, I don't remember BCCI not providing maternity leaves. But again, I'll have to check that again, because you're saying that they don't. So, I'm sorry not to be updated with that. Of course, it should be there. It's there. It's everywhere in every other field. It's there. You get maternity leave. You get paternity leave also. for BCCI. BCCI does give paternity leave, so I'm sure BCCI must be giving maternity leave as well. But opting for other jobs, yeah, Virat Kohli did opt for one.
That's a male cricket. This is about the female part.
No, of course. I'm saying paternity leave. Yes. He's giving just an example for paternity. But when it comes to opting for other jobs while you are in maternity leave, that is something that definitely I'll have to check and sort of learn more about it. In terms of BCCI's rules and regulation, because I haven't got a chance to follow that up. But yeah, I mean, it's things, of course, being a woman, it is important that I, even while on a maternity leave, I'm able to, work, and if not work somewhere else, at least I get paid from BCCI if I'm representing India. So, which I think that BCCI already does, but let's keep it for another session is what I'm going to put it that way. As in terms of women's T20 cricket, well, of course, it's not as viewed as the mighty men's cricket, but you also have to acknowledge and respect the fact that cricket goes way ahead, way behind in history, and it has always been a male-dominated sport. Having said that, and with the way things are now, I think time is changing. People are actually viewing people are actually wanting their child, their daughters to actually replay cricket and represent India. So yes, of course, there's a change. It's slow, but it's there. It has begun. I mean, you have to also acknowledge the culture that we live in, right? Where of course, not, and I'm not speaking for nowadays. I'm speaking for past. Like personally, even I faced trouble as a kid while playing cricket. And not from my family. Like my family always supported it, but it was more of the partnership and the participation in the team. Because first of all, it's very difficult to find 11 women to play in a college to play cricket, let alone, and then you have to, find another team to compete with. So I remember while I was in college, I always had to make a team of, I could make a team of 12 or 14, and then we would play six-a-side. Because men would definitely not allow me, because I would have been the only single woman to play with men in terms, and they would be like, you'll get hit with the ball, or the guys would be uncomfortable if you're around. So they would keep me around for scoring and being an umpire and stuff like that. And, let me throw some balls in the practice session. But yeah, like, it's not just that women T20 league is facing a difficult time in comparison with the men's T20 league. You also have to accept and acknowledge the fact that it just doesn't come from there. It comes from each and every household in the nation, the families have to support their women. The family has to support and rather promote the woman if she wants to play. And not just that, the people around have to allow her. I mean, allow in itself is very, growth stopping word. But then at the same time, this is a challenge that I faced. I'm sure many women around faced that, because I have friends who have faced that problem. And even my mentor faced that problem. So, but yeah, I mean, it's changing. So I'm happy with the way things are changing. I mean, there are advertisements based on the women cricketers. They are sponsoring a lot of big brands. They are, every now and then we see some or the other female cricketer who's coming up with some other sponsorship deal, some other contract. So it's changing, it's evolving, and it's, let's go by the pace and let's hope that things are way better. And I'll just take this opportunity through this episode and, kind of invite whoever watches it. And I hope you get to spread the word that let the girls play, and girls should also play. It's not just that the families are not allowing, the girls are themselves not as interested in cricket. At least not in my times, they were not. So just girls just play. Cricket is a lovely sport and it helps you mint money. So please pick. And the boys also, please just, you know, we can take the hit from the ball or the bat. That's okay. You can get scratched. So, yeah, allow the girls to play with you. At least start collaborating in, you know, representation should be there.
So you are saying like we have to take a reference from our football, like for example, England Football Association, which has just started the thing like giving equal opportunity to men and women, and even the equal pay scale for both men and women. That was followed by, I think, Brazil Football Federation. So we have to take example. See, cricket football, I consider cricket or football. There we do. There is some contrary. Say people say slow. I know, as you also mentioned, I was mentioning, but sports is sports. So if we're taking our reference to sports, so we have to take reference from anywhere.
Correct. No, absolutely. Absolutely correct. I mean, taking reference in terms of, you know, payment scales and giving equal opportunity, not just payment scales, just giving equal opportunity in every manner that is possible. And if it, even if it's coming, it could come from anywhere. You know, it could come from other sporting associations and it could come from other fields also. It's not, you don't have to restrict yourself to sports. While I agree completely with you in terms of referring to football associations, and in fact, I was going through the FC Barcelona's page the other day, and they have a well-settled and very, I think, growing female football team. So yeah, I mean, it's a good thing if you can just see. You should. My view is that you should take positive sides from anywhere. Like, you should have your hands open to any and every positive sort of way ahead for, in terms of promoting the sport for both males and females. So yeah, sure, why not? I mean, if that's one thing that we can take from football, I'm all up for it.
I'm adding to that, if you noticed, in terms of football, Indian women have actually of lately done a better thing. Like, if you notice, Bala Devi and Aditi Chauhan, I think both of them got selected by European football clubs. So, and if you notice recently, I don't think any Indian footballer has gotten a right contract. So that way, women are, they are performing better in a few scales.
Right. No, so women in sport, as I said before, women in sport, apart from the fact that the families have to be supported, it's the woman herself who has to be, you know, brave enough. I mean, it's tough. Yes, it's tough. It was tough for me. And that's the only reason why I had to, you know, change sides. Like, I wanted to play for, I got selected for the state team, but I could never pursue it further. There were other issues also, but then the focus, the choice was studies, and you have to give up studies. You know, if you want to give your life to cricket, for that matter, any sport, you have to give up something else. So that was something non-negotiable. So I gave education my priority. I kept it as a priority, and I sort of switched, or I don't know, in a smart manner, and I brought sports back into my life. But yeah, the women have to be brave enough to follow their dreams. Anyone, not just women. I mean, this is something that I was doing this another interview, and she asked me the same question, that what are the challenges you face as a woman? Well, of course, participation was one, but then other than that, it's not just that, it's women who's facing challenges in this field. It's everybody is. So opportunities should be given. Yes. So yeah, I mean, kudos to the football associations and the football female players. So, I mean, if that's one thing that we can learn, so I'm a huge, how do I say, applaud. I can applaud every sports person, as long as it's, you know, see, sports person are always helping you out. If you just follow them, they are helping you out. So yeah, football, basketball, even for that matter, equestrian, doesn't matter. Sports person is a sports person.
So you are
Shubhrajit, you are on mute.
Yeah, sorry. Even like when Sachin, like people say, the Sachin is the first person to score 200. For me, Sachin is not first person to, like, if you are considering person means male and female, anyone. So for me, Sachin is not the first person to go for a 200. And that's also why a woman. And I think that is Blenda Clark, I think, from Australia. She was the first one. She's a woman cricketer. She was the first one. to come with 200. So yeah, we have seen the women who are much more better than the men now. So
obviously, and as long as you're inspired, that's what matters, right? So you yourself are, you said in the initial time, and I'm sorry to stress it again, that you know cricket is boring, but then again you're also inspired from it. So as long as it's helping you, I'm happy.
And even Shefali Verma, people used to say Sachin is the youngest cricketer. So that record is also great.
Yeah.
But Shefali, that's another female. And I think 15 years, what's his age when he joined for T20? Something 15 years, something 239 days.
237, I think. So, I think it's 237, but then I'll take your cue on 239.
So, just to
add on to that, I'm sorry to cut you short. Just to add on to that, to be honest, personally, having said all of the things that we have, I don't think it, and that's the one thing that's where I start from. I don't think that we should be compared with the men's part, you know, the men's cricket or men's football. See, women have their own teams. Women, they should compete amongst themselves rather than competing with the men. You know, their world is different and women's world is different. Like, but yeah, when it comes from a point of view of an organization or association, of course, you have to think for the both of them. But when it comes, I don't personally think that we should compare both the sides, be it any sport. But yeah, having said that also, organizations and everybody should think for both of them. So let's not compare, compare amongst the field instead of with the other field.
Right, ma'am. Rightly said. Thank you so much, ma'am. So we're running out of time. So I have one last question for you. This is in regard with other sports. Now we've spoken about cricket that's gotten the most amount of recognition in our country. So in regard with, you know, the lower sports, if you notice a low scale cricket tournament in any state for that matter, the winner, they get the monetary, the amount of money involved is still a lot. At the same time, if you look at a national level athlete or a high jumper or something, the prize they get are things like pressure cookers and stuff. So I'm saying, do you think the lower sport gets shadowed by cricket?
Okay, here again, I'll correct you in terms of what I think. You should not term that as lower sports, or you should not term that as, see, recognition is important. Yes, I'm not saying that recognition is not important, but you also have to, again, as I said before, you also have to acknowledge the fact of the way the society has been developed. It's not that the sport is not being recognized or the players are not being recognized. They are not being recognized at that large a level. So as I said before, you don't have to really compare. They are being recognized, you know. And people who appreciate other sports other than the crickets and the likes of cricket and football, or say for that matter, hockey. But then other sports are being recognized. Yes, I mean, and as a lawyer, we've worked for every sport that is there at the center. I've been able to work for esports also, for that matter. So it's not that, yes, you're correct to the part that it's not, cricket is widely recognized, or the amount of money that cricket earns or, you know, pays to the cricketers is different from that. But then you also have to, when it comes to comparing between cricket and other sports, you also have to recognize the fact that cricket is run by BCCI, which is a private entity. It's not funded by the government, while other entities are funded by government. Like, they have national federations and they're funded by the ministry. And ministry has a budget. As a ministry has to take care of everything around. I mean, the sports ministry cannot just, you know. So BCCI is focused on cricket, right? But sports ministry has handful of games in their bag. So they have to take care of every single bag, and they have a sort of budget which they, you know, have to strategize and allocate accordingly. So I'm not saying that it should not be recognized. Of course, that is definitely not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, yes, it should be recognized more, but then at the same time, you cannot compare. I mean, of course, the sponsors, it also comes out from the viewership, from the sponsors' interest, from the participation amongst the people. So it's not just the organization that you can blame. You have to take care of also the other factors. like there has to be a participation from your own also. I mean, I don't want to allege you or accuse you, but you tell me, how many sports you watch other than the mainstream sports? You know, how we know the name. I mean, I know the name of the current team, you know, I know which team, but I know the name of the squad, but then for the next tournament. But then at the same time, I said that, do you know who like the entire Olympic squad? I'm sure. I mean, it's I don't know that the entire Olympic squad. Like, I know the sports and I know the major names, but it's not that every other sport. So it doesn't come just from the organization. It also comes from within, you know, your interests and your intentions to sort of support other sports. But having said that, when it comes to the amount, yes, of course, recognition should be there. It motivates you. You know, what is the ultimate? It's the reward that you get when you, you know, play at that juncture. But then, of course, it's important. Motivation is important. It helps you perform better. But then I think it's in the end, it's the passion. But then at the same time, yes, it should be recognized more. And it has to start from this. Yeah, I don't want to disturb any organizational feelings.
No worries, ma'am. You actually explained it really well, and it makes a lot of sense. It actually should firstly come from each and every one of us. So, Subhrajit sir, would you like to give an unofficial vote of thanks to ma'am?
Yeah, it's really a good viewpoint, and we've spent 40 minutes. Like, time is also running away, but we haven't felt like we have spent 40 minutes because it was really like we have a really nice talk with you, and like, and it was very, I want to say, like a well-known, like knowledgeable session to go. And I think nowadays, after listening to you, maybe female will also get chance. I mean, boys will give now female to chance after we discuss.
I hope. I mean, Ryan, you should start doing yourself. I don't know if Shubhaji plays that much or not. You should start creating a team for the women, because you're still there in the law school. So, I mean, I'll be honest. I'm sorry to interrupt the word of thanks. I don't know, we are running out of time. But when it comes to my college days, I also have, you know, guy friends who would let me play, you know, who would help me find a team, and not just cricket, for every sport, you know. So I've had the chance and opportunity to sort of play every sport that was there in my college and represent the university wherever I could. But having said that, yes, please, Shubhaji, please go ahead.
Yeah, that's sorry for, I will take 2 minutes. I mean, not minutes, second. Because I have also seen from my childhood, as I mentioned, my mom used to play for cricket for a state level. So I have seen how people are like playing there. So yeah, it should be like that only. And we have to come out from the orthodox thinking, because it's already a 21st century. So that's all.
Right. Thank you so much, sir. Yes, ma'am, your point is noted. And every other lawyer, every one of you are in law school. I already do that. Like ma'am pointed, let's more than letting them play, let's start persuading more of them to start playing. I know all of us are involved in our sports committees in our law school. So let's take that up as a challenge to get more people involved. So yes, thank you so much, Rashi ma'am, for accepting our invitation. Once again, on behalf of Global Sports Policy Review, thank you, ma'am. And a goodbye to everyone. Stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ryan, for having me. And yeah, please stay safe, everyone.